HPE is a sponsor of our coverage from OpenStack in Barcelona. Learn more about HPE Helion, the hybrid cloud, and what it all means for the enterprise customer at hpe.com. Learn more again at hpe.com.
Hello, this is Joab Jackson from the New Stack, and welcome to another edition of the New Stack Makers podcast. Today I got the team from NGINX here. NGINX, we've been covering NGINX quite a bit. It's a high-performance web server, app server, reverse proxy that is used by some of the heaviest used web sites in the world. And so we want to get an update. And first of all, let me have each of you gentlemen introduce yourself.
Gus Robertson, CEO of NGINX.
Mm-hmm. Hi, I'm Owen Garrett, Head of Products at NGINX.
All right.
And Peter Guagenti, I'm the CMO at NGINX.
All right, Russ, Owen, and Gus.
Gus, Owen, and Peter.
Oh, that's okay.
Close enough.
All right, excellent. Well, anyway, yeah, let's. You know, we've covered NGINX quite a bit, but you know, what's new with the company? How are you guys doing? What's happening?
Well, I touched on a couple of topics there. In terms of the company, let's also talk about the open source project.
Oh, please. Yeah.
So NGINX open source now is at around 196 million plus websites around the world. We are number one for the top 1,000, 10,000, 100,000 busiest sites. So open source NGINX just continues to grow in its adoption in the marketplace, which is something that we've spent a lot of energy and time focusing on over the last 5 years since we started the company.
Sure.
We are the ambassadors and bastions for NGINX open source. 70% of our engineering resource goes into improving the open source product, making sure it's the best web server and reverse proxy on the planet, and we continue to strive to achieve that. As a company now, we've got about 1,000 commercial customers that are now using NGINX Plus, the commercial offering.
Huh.
NGINX Plus extends the open source product from being a web server and reverse proxy to being an application delivery platform. So it extends NGINX with more load balancing, monitoring capabilities, application health checks, media streaming, all the things you need to really do two things. Load balancing at the front end of an application, akin to what you would use hardware appliances to do in the past from companies like F5 and Citrix. And also on the back end to build a microservice or distributed architecture for application design.
Huh.
And so that's where we've been focusing our efforts for NGINX Plus. As a company, we now have over 100 employees, which is, I guess, a milestone of sorts. We've been growing the business at more than 100% year on year. We tripled the business last year over the previous year, and this year we continue to grow at a similar rate. So the company's doing well, the open source project's doing well, and we're here at OpenStack to promote NGINX, to do two things, to promote NGINX as part of OpenStack, but actually also to build our presence here in Europe, because we've been very focused as a company from a commercial perspective in the US primarily, but we're seeing a lot of demand coming in from Europe, particularly UK and Germany.
Huh.
So we wanted to sort of show our presence and our support of the market here by being at this event today and also launching a European sales office.
Oh, wow, terrific. All right, yeah. Fantastic. So I want to circle around to the microservices a bit later,
sure,
because that's one of our main coverage areas. But first, let's ask you, recently there's been an update to the commercial offering, NGINX Plus 11. I was wondering if you'd tell me a bit about what's new, what's in the box.
Sure, Joe, happy to talk about R11. So as Gus explained, we have a commercial offering, and we release that every 3 to 4 months.
Okay.
R11 was pulled forward, in fact, because we had some really interesting technology that we wanted to bring to our users as soon as possible. And it's the culmination of about a year and a half's worth of work to unify the way that our open source product and our commercial product can pull in third-party code. Now, that sounds like a bit of an obscure thing to want to do. But the reason that that's so important to us is that, as Gus described, there is immense momentum behind our open source product. There is a community of module developers and experts who create extensions, code modifications, code add-ons to the open source product.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of our users depend critically on those extensions for value-add features, things like security, authentication, mm-hmm. caching. And we wanted to make sure that our commercial users who get a great service from us as a company can also get the same level of service using those third-party extensions.
Excellent. So how does one write a third-party extension?
So one writes an extension as a bit of C code. C, because that's the core language that NGINX is written in.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very high performance. Fits perfectly with the ethos of NGINX. One writes the extension, complies to the API, so the descriptions that we provide about how the extension should work, publishes the extension as you like. All of these extensions are published by third parties. They could be individuals, they could be other companies, they could even be commercial vendors. And those extensions are published and distributed in whatever way meets the needs of the author. Often they're published in GitHub, and we manage an index, a repository, listing all of the current extensions for NGINX. And with this latest R11 release, we've now provided a way that you can take these third-party extensions, and you don't have to, you're not restricted to just using them with NGINX open source. Now with R11, you can use those extensions with our commercial supported product. So if you're one of the 1,000 users or a growing number of users of our commercial product, you benefit from the extra features, the support that we provide, the maintained releases that we provide. You can now pull in all of these value-add features from other sources and link them in with a core product to make it so much richer and so much more powerful.
So the previous editions of the commercial version of NGINX didn't support the modules, or was it something that people were adding on by themselves?
That's right.
Yeah.
So our commercial product is closed source.
Mm-hmm.
We don't provide the source code to our users. And before today, you had to have access to the source code in order to link a module with NGINX. And what we have done now is created binary compatibility between the open source and the commercial product. So put simply, that means mm-hmm. that you can take a module, you can compile it for the open source product, but you can then load mm-hmm. the resulting code into the commercial product. So it's the same code, the same compiled binary, and it runs on both our open source product, used by millions, tens of millions of people worldwide, and on our very high quality, high performance commercial product.
Excellent. So the modules are loaded at runtime?
That's right.
All right.
That's exactly right. And they extend the core of NGINX.
Mm-hmm.
They do things like add security capabilities mm-hmm. or other APIs or programming languages that run on top of NGINX. So that means at the kernel, the very mm-hmm. core, you have the trusted, reliable NGINX Plus binary
mm-hmm.
built and distributed by us. You don't have to go and build NGINX yourself and cross your fingers and hope and know that if something goes wrong, you're not supported.
Right.
Instead, you have the supported core, and we've opened it up in the sense that you can now add your own extensions into that supported core. You don't just have to take modules that other people have written. You can also write your own extensions and load those in.
You said supports other languages. How would I use that in an average deployment?
So NGINX, as I mentioned, is written in C, and it's configured with a simple, straightforward configuration file that enables a lot of functionality. But sometimes people want to go a little bit further than that. They need to go off-piste. They want to do something particularly sophisticated on how NGINX manages traffic.
Sure.
And currently, there are a couple of third-party language implementations. A very popular one uses Lua.
Huh.
Another one uses Java, and you can link that code into the NGINX core. We have our own Perl implementation, so you can write code in Perl and
mm-hmm.
link that in the core. Another thing which we're working on, and we'll be releasing more information about in the next couple of months, is a JavaScript implementation. This is another long-term project.
Uh-huh.
We've been sharing previews and betas with our users for the last 12 months. And that's getting close to production ready.
Nice.
And this is going to allow you to write your NGINX configuration using JavaScript.
this would allow the front-end developers to also add some back-end capabilities
That's
as well.
Right. Oh. So JavaScript is a very well-understood language, very widely adopted by our user base. And what this will allow you to do is to write logic of how NGINX should handle traffic using the language you're familiar with. Mm-hmm. So you might want to put in some sophisticated rule on how traffic should be load balanced.
Right.
With JavaScript, if you can verbalize, express what you want to do, you can then code it up. I want users who are coming from China, who have not authenticated with a cookie, who are accessing this part of the website, to be routed to these servers. If you can verbalize it, you can then use the capabilities in NGINX to apply that to your traffic. So NGINX becomes a really powerful gatekeeper front end for your web application. And business logic that doesn't apply directly to the application, it applies to the traffic, can then be applied using NGINX and JavaScript. And this will elevate NGINX far beyond where it is now. It won't just
say,
the best ever web server and a fantastic load balancer. It will become the tool that you use to control how your users interact with your services.
Nice. So there are a lot of third-party extensions. Is there like a rating system, or do you review them, or how would I know that this extension from this party won't crash my deployment, basically?
So the first step is to use the power of the community. We track and we score the number of accesses.
Nice.
So you can find which extensions are popular and which ones are less popular. So you can infer from that which ones are well regarded, which ones are frequently updated. But what we do on top of that is that we pick some of the most popular extensions. Things like the Lua module that I mentioned, extensions that a large number of our open source users use. And we take those and we compile those up, we test them, and we distribute them directly with NGINX Plus. So if you want to use one of these really popular modules, you don't even have to build it yourself and use it with Plus. We will do everything for you. And we will provide support. So if you have trouble getting that module to function with NGINX Plus, our support team are here to help.
Even if it's not your module?
Even if it's not our module, we will do our best to help you get it up and running, do the basic configuration, and if necessary, help you interact with the community to find the answers that you need using that module.
Excellent. This also sounds like it's an opportunity for your partners to build value-add services that they themselves...
Exactly.
So that's great news. What else is new with Release 7? There's a couple other new things.
So with Release 11, I said, we pulled it forwards because we wanted to get this dynamic modules compatibility feature in front of our users as quickly as possible.
Right.
We've also pulled in some additional new features.
Right.
NGINX Plus is used as a load balancer. And although our heritage is in web traffic, in HTTP, when people deploy a load balancer, they often want to use it to manage other types of protocols as well.
Right.
Simple TCP protocols, database transactions, or UDP transactions.
Oh, okay.
And over the last year, we've been building up the capabilities in NGINX Plus to be a fantastic load balancer for TCP traffic, for UDP traffic, as well as HTTP.
Right.
This release rolls up some more features around TCP and UDP load balancing, better technology around health checks. It brings in some of the JavaScript capabilities that I've mentioned.
All right.
And
excellent.
We'll be releasing some solutions through our blog over the next couple of days, where we explain how you can use NGINX Plus to load balance traffic to MySQL, to build a highly available, scalable MySQL cluster, to perform health checks against that cluster, so you can route away from failed nodes, and to get some great stats and visualization using the dashboard in NGINX Plus to understand how that service is working.
Excellent. So I would have replicated MySQL servers on the back end, and they're all coordinating the traffic, and then I can send a lot of traffic their way. NGINX will load balance.
That's exactly how it would work, Joe. So we work with technologies like MySQL, Galera, to do the replication at the back end, and then we provide the secure, reliable front end so that all of your incoming traffic is handled by NGINX, is secured, there's a single point of entry, and then we load balance that across the back ends, health check the back ends, let you know if there's a performance problem or an availability problem.
Huh. All right, nice. All right, fantastic, fantastic. And that's available now, or is it?
Yes, okay, so that technology is available now, right. And there are solutions on our website describing how to configure MySQL, and solutions around other protocols as well, things like DNS, to help you build reliable, scalable services of almost any type.
Terrific, terrific. All right, fantastic. So you had mentioned microservices. Now, I think microservices, this is all architecture that's going on behind the load balancer, but NGINX has an interest in what's happening in the field of microservices.
Yeah, if you actually look, it's not just behind the load balancer, right? What we've really seen with microservices architecture is a shift towards HTTP being the lingua franca of microservices. So our role actually increased as microservices rose. If you actually look at sort of the reference architecture for Netflix, which is probably the architecture everyone sort of looks to first as the shiny example, we were a heavy participant in that. NGINX is actually what connects each of those microservices, and that's what we see today. We see now today a world where we get customers coming to us and saying, I need something that's going to connect, that's going to secure, and it's going to scale all of my microservices. And that's our role, right? We sit at each one of those microservices. Within each microservice, we actually connect all of them. We handle the authorization between them. We handle things like rate limiting or connection limiting, so you don't DDoS yourself with API calls. And we are that connective tissue. And that's increasingly something we see as the standard.
Now, does NGINX do a service discovery, or?
You can use NGINX for service discovery. We also play well with a number of other systems that enable that. And works well both for traditional microservices as well as container-based delivery.
Wow, that's fantastic. I had no idea. I'm just so ignorant on what's happening these days.
It's interesting. If you look at any of the tools that are available in microservices, we are probably the most ubiquitous, right? Huh. You'll find NGINX literally at every one of those instances, as the web server, as a proxy, as a load balancer. We're connected to the API gateways. We're doing SSL termination. We're doing authorization. We're living at each one of those points. In fact, what Owen and Gus were describing around both the additional modules as well as engine script is about actually making those things even easier and even more powerful.
Wow. All right. Nice. Fantastic. Now, how in terms of your user base, how many of the companies that you work with or organizations you work with are investigating microservices or already? I mean, in addition to Netflix, of course.
It's been amazing to watch. If you look, we've been kind of seen as one of the leaders in the microservices space, so we have a lot of inbound interest coming into us from customers about microservices. I'd say over the last 12 months, if you think 12 to 6 months ago, it was mostly, I'm learning about microservices, I'm trying to understand where it would impact us, how we would implement, but not many of those customers were actually going into production with a microservice architecture. That's absolutely changed in the last 6 months. More so the last 3 months, we've actually been on-site helping customers transition either monolith applications to microservices or natively building out a new application architecture using microservices. One of the things that we spent the last 12 months working on is how to help customers accelerate that process, because that's the thing that's most important to a customer is how do I do this successfully based on the best performance benchmarks of how others have done it, and how can you, NGINX as a company, accelerate my adoption. So we've built a reference architecture for microservices. Think of it as a sort of more simplified approach and a more sophisticated approach. So there's 3 different layers in there, but each of those is designed, depending on the type of application and complexity of the application, to give you the right architecture that can get your team up and running so that it's all about just getting the code out. It's not about trying to get the fabric and the connection points right. That's what we can provide.
Excellent. This reference architecture, is this online? Or?
Yeah.
It is.
All right.
So you can go to our blog post. You can see the microservice reference architecture. We've even started training programs around the microservice architecture. We delivered our first external training program publicly to our user base at our user event in Austin, NGINX Conf, in September this year.
Oh, terrific. All right, fantastic. Now, one thing we've noticed our readers have been very interested in lately is monitoring. And we're actually putting together a book on container monitoring, and we're looking more into microservices monitoring. Now, you guys had just introduced a product earlier this year called Amplify.
That's right.
Could you talk a bit about what does that do? Where does that fit?
Sure. So monitoring and tracking your instances is really important if you want to understand how your application is performing, what the volume of traffic coming in is, the rates of errors, if you have any errors, or slowdowns. And we have created Amplify as a SaaS-based product to help you do that. The intent, we know that there are a large number of users taking NGINX open source who don't have the time or the skills or the even the budget to bring in an expensive enterprise-grade monitoring solution. But, and we also know that NGINX, as the bump in the wire, is the one thing that can see everything that's happening with your application. So we're developing a SaaS-based product called Amplify, which will do exactly that for you. The goal is that you will be able to feed information from each of the NGINX instances you're running, whether NGINX Open Source or NGINX Plus. Those instances will call back to the Amplify monitoring platform. You can claim those instances as your own, and then you can access the monitoring platform, and you can see how your application is performing by inferring that from the data that NGINX calls back. Volumes of traffic, latency, availability of components, all of that in a simple, easy to use, very accessible user interface.
Excellent. So this is a hosted service then?
That's right.
Is it, is the service grabbing the log files, or is this data being pushed out in real time, or how does that work?
It pulls data from a range of different sources from NGINX. We put a lot of thought into the way that the data is collected and shared back to the Amplify platform, so you can control very precisely how the data is filtered and anonymized, so you can be confident that none of your sensitive data is going off-premise. And it pulls data from log files and a range of other sources that it can instrument on the host that's running NGINX, whether it's in a container, whether it's in a virtual machine, whether it's running on a cloud like Amazon. The platform will monitor NGINX wherever it is.
Nice. And it sounds like the users can shape the data. I mean, they could bundle it into what they define as services, or export it, or whatnot. Okay.
So the product is still in a beta stage. We're taking feedback from our users. There's an open beta. People can come to nginx.com/amplify, sign up, get access to the agent, configure their NGINXs to call back to Amplify. And one of the latest features we've been working on is exactly as you described, Joab. We call them customized dashboards. You can select the data fields that you're interested in, you can group those into a report, and then you can create a dashboard that generates those graphs and charts in a report to give you the metrics that you need.
Nice, nice. All right, fantastic. So we're here on the show floor of OpenStack, the OpenStack Summit in Barcelona. And I'm a little bit surprised to see you guys here. I don't really think of OpenStack and NGINX in the same thought, usually. But obviously you guys are here. You guys are here for a reason. I was wondering if you could talk a bit about why you're making a presence here.
I'm a little surprised to hear you say that you wouldn't imagine this together. When, in the keynotes, I think we were mentioned 3 or 4 times across various customers. So it's, we're fairly ubiquitous. We actually do not have an OpenStack-specific build of NGINX Plus. That's not why we're here. We're not hawking a specific product. But we are a fairly common component of not just the OpenStack implementations, but this type of customer. Right? So what we really see most often today is that NGINX Plus is being deployed across companies that are choosing to go to both public and private cloud, and also probably still dealing with their own data centers. Because we run equally as well, whether it's on bare metal commodity hardware or AWS or Google or Azure, or on your own private cloud infrastructure. You know, being a software tool, the way we're designed, the way we're architected, we work very well. We've been sponsoring OpenStack actually for a little over a year now. And actually we went to Austin and had a number of amazing conversations, not just bringing new customers in, but actually spending time with existing users as well, existing customers, and helping to understand a little bit better of what they're trying to accomplish today. So we're really grateful to be here. I think obviously we're also being one of the largest open source projects in the world. We love supporting other open source projects. And it's been a great event for us.
So OpenStack users, how would you describe, if they're using both NGINX and OpenStack, what's the connection between the two? Is OpenStack running the apps, or the web apps that are that NGINX serves as a front end to, or what's happening?
We are serving as a front end for a number of the applications that are being deployed on OpenStack. Mm-hmm. We are seeing that. But actually, we're here not just for that. I mean, we're here because what we're really seeing is the OpenStack users are those who are trying to solve for portable applications. They're trying to solve for more optimized use of their infrastructure. They're trying to solve for cloud in a larger context and containers in a larger context. So the conversations we have many times are about OpenStack infrastructure, but many times not at all. And that's why we're here. We're really here less because it's OpenStack and more because this is a community of users who are doing interesting things with cloud infrastructure today, and we want to be here to support them.
All right, fantastic. Well, gentlemen, I thank you so much for taking time to get us up to speed on what's happening with NGINX, and definitely keep in contact.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks very much.
HPE is a sponsor of our coverage from OpenStack in Barcelona. Learn more about HPE Helion, the hybrid cloud, and what it all means for the enterprise customer at hpe.com. Learn more again at hpe.com. Thank you.